Hello, and welcome to episode number 25 of Office Hours. I am your host, Adam Coble. This is my office. This is the hour. Today, I'm going to answer... I was going to say three, but somebody's a dirty cheater today, and they asked two questions. So I'm going to answer 3 7/10 of a question today from you, my beloved audience. You can submit these questions if you want to get involved. You know, you'd think after saying this 25 times, I would be able to just like rattle off something, but I try to make it a little bit different every time, which is to say, you can join in the Office Hours fun by going to www.adam-coble.com/office-hours and filling out the form and pressing the button, and then I'll get your question. You can record your lovely voice. And if you don't want to or don't feel comfortable doing so, hop in the old Math Squad Discord and you can find a ringer. There have been a non-zero number of ringers for these questions. So that's fun. Today's questions cover a variety of topics, as we often do. And I've picked some topics about non-specific game stuff. So we're not going to be looking at... prepping for particular games. We're going to be looking at building encounters. We're going to be talking more about some of the stuff we can do mentally to prepare for games, to play games, and to manage games as GMs, because as we know, often a lot of that social pressure to be the person in charge falls to us. I was thinking about this. This is our first episode back from TwitchCon, and I was thinking about this at TwitchCon. People came up to me a lot. This is going to be it's anecdotal story time. We're going to take a short pause before we get to the first question. I'm going to tell a little story about life skills. It's going to be an affirming story. It's going to be a story of heartwarming self-awareness, and I hope that it will resonate for some of you. It's going to be a short story. I think the intro is going to take just as long as the story did. Anyway, so TwitchCon, as with many other conventions, I was organizing and moderating some panels. Panels are one of my favorite things to do at a convention. I wouldn't say they're my favorite things to do in the world in general, but they're fun at conventions. You know, it gives you an opportunity to give back to the space, to entertain people, to inform, and I ran a couple of panels, and almost universally, people asked me afterwards, whether in the moment or online, you know, on Twitter, like, hey, I saw your panel, it was really good. How did you get to be so good at running panels? And this is a thing, this is a question that I would get in my old life as an advertiser, as a person who would help pitch ad programs to clients, who would run meetings. And people would ask me, you know, you don't really look like the meeting sort. You're not a sales guy. How did you get to learn how to become a meeting master? And the answer to both of those questions is dungeon mastering. And it gets a laugh every time I say it. I'm like, I just dungeon mastered that panel. I just dungeon mastered that meeting. Dungeon master your clients. As a GM, you pick up skills around wrangling people, right? Like getting people to focus on a thing, getting them to head in the same direction together, highlighting each person's individual contributions, you know, moving the spotlight around. It's exactly the same set of skills. If you're a good GM, you can run a panel. If you're a good GM, you can organize a presentation or a sales meeting. And the opposite is true. Look at places in your day-to-day non-fantasy tabletop role-playing life. Look at your life and see places where you're already performing your GM skills. And give yourself a little pat on the back for that shit. I bet you can find something. It's a joke that there's, you know, people putting raid leader on their resume, but that shit is real. It's totally a thing. So, you know, that's something I just wanted to instill in you, that GMing skills, and we've talked about this over and over on the show, GMing skills come from all kinds of places, right? It's not just about reading the Dungeon Master's Guide and suddenly being Gary Gygax. Don't be Gary Gygax. It's about looking at your life, looking at the performative aspects, looking at the organizational aspects, looking at the creative things that you do as a person, and recognizing that those skills are game master skills. Just a little food for thought. Maybe a little inspiration for the opening of the episode. Let's get to our first question, shall we?
Hey, Adam. I have a friend who just got funding from the U.S. Embassy for a project to teach people English using role-playing games, and I was wondering if you have any advice on how to GM for people whose first language isn't English. Also, since he'll be doing this in a post-conflict society with a pretty noticeable ethnic divide, I was hoping that you could add some advice on how to build an atmosphere around the table that's conducive to friendships that will last longer than the campaign. Sorry for asking two questions instead of one, but, you know, they're, like, related. I hope you're having a good day.
I am having a good day. Thank you, Cactus. Thank you, Existential Cactus. So, all right, you asked two questions. You asked two questions, and that's your big cheater, but that's okay, because as you said, they're related, and they're too good. They're too good. I can't not answer both of them. You got me. You found my secret weakness. So, we're gonna answer both of these. So, I only have a little experience playing role-playing games with people whose first language isn't English. Honestly, like, the people I play with tend to be people from North America. They speak English as a first language, or their expertise with English is such that even if it's their second language, it never occurs to me to consider this. And that part, while I was writing out the answer to this question, while I was like brainstorming, thinking about it, I don't think about that. But then I realized, like, I've played games, like, I played Dungeon World at a game shop in Japan with Japanese Dungeon World players. I played a bunch of different role-playing games in Italy with people who Italian was their first language. But this is the kind of thing that happens when you speak English as a first language and you don't think about this shit. It goes right over your head. So it never occurred to me to be like, maybe I should think about whether I'm... So we'll get hypothetical. I'll tell you what, if I were in this situation, if I were put in a position to use role-playing games as a means to express language to people who are learning that language, this is what I might do. I think it's really cool. We're really lucky that so much of the audience for Office Hours and for the channel in general are folks who come from countries that are not North America and who have a much broader language background. So while you're listening to this, think about your own experiences with multiple languages in groups. Maybe you've got a group that is, you know, mixed English, French, and German speakers, right? Maybe you've got a group, maybe you're from a place that has a bunch of different regional dialects. Think about how you interact with language and role-playing games. And I'm going to talk to you about my experience and what I might do. But obviously, this is going to vary really heavily. I don't have a ton of experience with non-English speaking players. So anyway, hypothetically, I think what I would probably do is try to get an understanding, you know, not only of how well they speak English conversationally, right? Like, that's important, right? Being able to be like, can we have a conversation, and at what level of complexity can that conversation be had, right? You got to figure that out first, so you got to spend time with people, you got to be around them. But I would also want to get an idea, and this is a thing that I think we slip on a lot, I would like to get an idea of how much cultural overlap we have, right? You know, I'm thinking about how a lot of the time people, which is to say, nerds, we've been steeped in this grand Western tradition of fantasy and like nerd shit, right? So we tend to assume everyone has access to the same cultural resources, right? And I don't think that that's true. It's almost certainly not true, in fact. You know, just because we know what tropes make up Dungeons and Dragons, for example, it doesn't mean that everybody else does. I'm going to ask you to imagine a paladin, right? Think about a paladin. Like, just close your eyes, just take a minute, envision a paladin in your head. What does this paladin look like? What are they wearing? What are they holding? What is the look on their face like? How do they carry themselves? Where did you start, right? Like, for me, it's armor, right? It's plate armor or chainmail. It's a sword, it's a shield, it's a tabard with a holy symbol. It's an air of confidence and authority. All of that comes from playing Dungeons & Dragons. It comes from playing Warcraft. It comes from being exposed to a specific kind of tropal information, right? I could tell you what a paladin is. I could tell you what a wizard is about. I could give you several examples of a wizard. We could go from Harry Potter to Gandalf. You know, I could talk about the difference between a wizard and a sorcerer. I know what a vampire looks like. I know what a dragon is. I know what the Tarrasque is. I know what a displacer beast looks like. I know what a mind flayer is. You probably, as members of this audience, know most of that stuff too. But that might not be the case for somebody in a different culture. And what made me think about this was in the 80s, and I've talked about this before, the difference between Western and in this case, Japanese culture. In the 80s, there was a version of Dungeons & Dragons that came out in Japan. They were a little manga-sized basic D&D. Some illustrations, lots of text, but they came with a compendium volume that explained, here's all of this Western fantasy bullshit, you don't have any fucking clue what it is, we're gonna explain it for you, right? This is early 80s, this is, like, it's not to say there wasn't Western fantasy in Japanese culture, but for the most part, if you wanted a fantasy in Japan, in manga and anime, you got samurai, right? Of course, because it's rooted in the culture. So this book came out that was like, this is what a cleric is. This is what a wizard looks like. This is what a thief looks like. This is what a fighter is, because fighter translated directly into another language just is person who fights, and that doesn't make any fucking sense. So all of these things were explained in this book. And I think that's something that as a GM, even now, even decades later, we should be thinking about when we engage people whose backgrounds are different from our own and who may not have had the same access to or interest in the kinds of fiction and media that we did. So I would start with the material in the game, right? Because obviously you don't have to explain everything if it's not going to be part of your game. So talk about that, right? Same with any game group, no matter what language they speak. You want to sit down and you want to talk about your common touchstones. Talk about the stuff that you're excited about for the game and clear up questions of terminology, points of confusion. You know, in a lot of ways, being fluent in nerd is like a dialect of English. So even people whose grasp of English is really good conversationally, they might not know the difference between a guisarme and a tabard, right? This is like with any language. I speak a little bit of very... sort of strict, like, educated kind of like Japanese, right? My Japanese sounds like I learned it in a school. And someone that I know who speaks Japanese because she grew up there, we have a hard time communicating in Japanese because the way that we speak, the kinds of words that we choose to use in any given sentence may not be the same. So even if you both speak English, I might go on about what a sabaton is without realizing that you might not have the context for that information. You might not know the object that I'm referring to. So you can weave that into your initial sort of talk around the table about the game, what it's going to be like. Sharing an RPG, what it plays like, giving examples, feeling out that shared imaginative space. And as a GM, you know already, you know this, I know you do, your listening skills are more important than your speaking skills. So at this point, you got to be hearing what the players are getting excited about, right? Phrases like, oh, that sounds like this. Or, oh, like in that movie. You're listening for people's contextualization and building a map of the territory that you share culturally together, right? If all your players are really excited about the Avengers movies, you should probably play a superhero game rather than Dungeons & Dragons. Or, if you're playing D&D, frame things in a way that they're going to understand. When you describe your paladin, talk about how Captain America is a paladin of America, right? Commonality of reference space, hugely important. Think about that. This conversation is going to allow you to figure out spots that might be linguistically tricky and figure out how jargony, as a GM, you're going to be allowed to be. I think the real trick here is in playing the game and being sure to avoid terminology that no sane person would know otherwise until you've let it sink in. You know, we throw around as role-playing game players, we throw around shit like saving throw and to hit bonus and stuff like we all know what that means. And It's so fucking alienating to be a person trying to participate in a conversation, and we know that role-playing games are conversations, right? Then worrying about getting the terminology wrong, right? Like, just try to have a conversation about gender with a bunch of sociology students. Try to have a conversation about Marxism with a bunch of, like, hardcore leftists. It's going to be very difficult. This is why phrases like ludonarrative dissonance are a bit of a joke, unless you actually are using them in context and people understand what they mean. And so we, as nerds, have this lexicon. We have this sort of sub-language that we use to underlay the dorkiness of our English. So I think that's the main thing, right? You keep in mind the difference, and being willing, as anyone who's teaching anything should be, being willing to take it slow, to be patient. Explain things in not game terms, but what they mean in sort of real life or in the fiction. Explain, like, does anyone know why a saving throw is called a saving throw? Like, really, without thinking about it? We all know, we've all internalized it, but you're saving your character for something by throwing the dice. Like, if you really look at the language of role-playing games, they're kind of weird. So that's the main thing, right? Is not just cultural differences, but the sub-language, right? Because, yeah, okay, having a conversation with people who are limited in their skill, their undeveloped skill at English, is one thing. And a role-playing game is that thing. It's a conversation. So, you know, I don't think it's too different. It's just being able to impart the knowledge you have as a GM about the rules and the space, and then being able to bend that space around your players to fit their cultural expectations and their media consumption, and recognizing that it's different, right? And this is going to lead you as a GM to some really cool places, because if the people you're playing with read a comic book that is only really available in their country, and that's their cultural touchstone, you as a GM can invest in that. You can learn about that thing. You can watch the movies that they watch. You can watch the TV shows. You can talk with them about the culture and the things that they absorb. And you're going to get better not only as a GM, but as a person. Because as we absorb more culture, as we become more knowledgeable and learned, we become better people. And as for the other thing, about creating an environment around the table conducive to friendships, you know, it's a fascinating question, and not really one I've considered in that way. I think the thing is that, so, okay, I read an article once, and I wish that I had it for reference, but it's become anecdotal, but I read an article once about role-playing games being a popular pastime in the American prison system, for a while, at least. Because, as the article laid out, like reading, role-playing games encourage exercise of the mind. You can engage with them for several hours at a time in an environment that is, by definition, like, punitively boring. Apparently, though, you know, the role-playing games in prison thing, they put a kibosh on it because somebody paid attention to the games they were playing and deemed them violent. And so now, these inmates who were previously, you know, engaged, creative, doing things together, building teamwork skills, had to go without their hobby. And I'm not going to go into all of the reasons why taking Dungeons and Dragons away from inmates is bullshit, or even why the prison industrial complex is such a load of horseshit. But what I wanted to point out vis-a-vis this other question is that there's something to be said for the social nature, the social glue that role-playing games can provide in a place that can often be tense and otherwise potentially violent. And on a more personal side, I think I'm not alone in saying that role-playing games are, for me, one of the best forms of social interaction that I can think of. Now, I have some anxiety around social stuff. I'm a person that finds engaging with other people not a relaxing activity most of the time. Being in crowd situations, being in groups of people is very stressful for me, and I can find it really hard to get through that kind of interaction. And what I like about role-playing games is it's a structured conversational group activity. Right, it's a thing in which everyone has a goal, and there are constructed systems for knowing when it's okay to talk and when it's okay to listen and when you are meant to contribute. And we're all working together to build a thing that we enjoy. We're all telling each other stories. And I find that the process of creation is, it's an intimate one, even if it's silly or temporary. And honestly, for me, that intimacy of playing role-playing games with people fosters a non-role-playing form of intimacy as well. Most of my close friends I either met through role-playing games or have played role-playing games with before, and I see that as something that has improved my relationship with them. Right? My life is full of people that I care deeply about now because we met playing a tabletop role-playing game together and got to know each other through weekly play. Not just because we were in the same place, but because I think that people telling stories to other people is a way that we bond as humans. But I don't know that I've ever done this intentionally. I don't know that I've ever attempted to engineer a group of people getting to know each other better through a game, but I bet you could do it. And what I would do would be to pick a game that's strictly about working together, or make sure that in the early stages of your game, you lay out that the PCs are friends, allies, or comrades, at least, against a more dangerous world, that without each other, you're going to be in a much worse situation. So indicate to your players by way of your choice of games and the way you introduce those games that they might have friendly competition, but there's no reason for them to fight. You know, often I think that we turn to PvP in role-playing games as a way to resolve conflict in them, but we don't have to. Playing a game that has structures for resolving conflict or from the get-go says this is not a game about that. Play a game like Free Market. Free Market is an amazing game about artistic people collaborating on shit, which is what you're doing when you play a role-playing game anyway. You can spend time before and after the game talking with each other. This cements that you are people and not just characters. So what you want to do is give yourself some room for small talk. And I'll talk about this more in the next question. You want to think about social time outside the game, right? Now, this is where you can get a little intentional. And I think, honestly, again, going to go to the personal space here, but honestly, I think that being intentional about building friendships, building relationships of any kind, is really smart. And we're grown-ups. I don't know, maybe you're not a grown-up yet. That's okay. You will be. But you know, as adults, as people who strive for well-developed skills, I think that social intention is a big deal. I think that when you enter into a relationship with someone saying like, hey, I'd really like us to be closer friends, what can we do to get to know each other better? Or, I mean, this is just a form of building a sort of consent-based relationship with your friends. So sitting down with the people you're playing a tabletop game with, and when the game is done, saying, hey, y'all want to go get a drink? Like, you want to go and get some dinner? Do you want to talk about the game somewhere else? Like, do you want to move out of our game space and be social together outside of the game? You know, it's worth, I think, considering doing that. Getting a meal together is another really social activity. Eating food is like a thing that people do as a group. I know that post Dungeons & Dragons pizza has always been a nice bonding experience for me. Because again, it's a social situation in which you always have something to talk about, right? Like, you can all sit down and be like, oh my God, what about when this happened? Oh, that was amazing when that happened. How did you feel about this thing? You can roll in your post-game talk as another social activity. And I think that's a thing you can do, right? There's nothing wrong with being intentional about that. I think the thing is, like, just acknowledging that role-playing games can be incredibly social from the get-go, and you can use them to form bonds is a start. But like any friendship, forcing things doesn't work. You know, you can't sit a bunch of people down and say, play D&D, now you're friends. You have to look at the social energy around role-playing games and around that space and look at it as a fertile environment for social connection, but not inherently one that will grow friendships. Now, one last thing that I wanted to tack on to this particular question, because of the way that you phrased it. You know, I obviously don't know the details of the place or the players' lives or the situation that they're in, but because you use the phrase post-conflict, It might be worth your GM having a talk with the players about the kinds of things that they're comfortable experiencing in the game. You know, most folks who come to role-playing games don't have a history of being subjected to or surrounded by actual violence. And on the flip side, most role-playing games contain some degree or another of violence. So it might be worth talking about that and making sure that the game is a space in which people feel like they're not going to be confronted with traumatic content, because nothing beats social anxiety like having a panic attack, right? So creating that space, making that space comfortable is important. So yeah, that's what I think. Again, hypotheticals, hopefully though, hopefully they're helpful.
I'm calling you from Denmark to ask you about sort of very basic problem that seems to come up a lot with my group when we play. I almost always find that the first 15, 20, 25 minutes of actual play, my GM muscles kind of aren't really warmed up yet, so improvising and playing the NPCs and so on kind of tends to fall a little bit flat or come out a little stiff. To be clear, I'm talking after we jump into the action. We talk beforehand about where we're at in fiction and recap the last session and so on, but doesn't seem to do the trick for us. Maybe it's not only me, but kind of the whole group has to get into gear in the beginning of the session and get into the same space. Anyway, so my question is, do you have any recommendations for getting better at being in sync with the game, kind of from the get-go? Or maybe getting around the problem somehow, like trying to make the first few minutes of a session be kind of more low stakes, so we don't like start right in the middle of something where if I make a bad call somehow or something, it doesn't matter that much. I talk with my players about maybe trying to do some flashbacks at the beginning of session sometimes, but I was wondering if you had any experience or ideas with this sort of like very basic problem. Your thoughts would be greatly appreciated.
So the very first thing that I think everybody is thinking while we're listening to this, and I think Johannes is also thinking this too. He mentioned that they do take time at the beginning of the session. I'm going to talk about that. I'm going to talk about what to do with that. But the thing to remember here is that no matter how much we would like them to work this way, our brains aren't built to just go off in the direction that we aim them just because we decide that they should. We can't say to ourselves, I'm tired of thinking about this. I would like to think about something else. Or, I need to be focused on this thing now. I'm going to focus. It's just not a thing that we can do. We can learn skills. We can practice shit like meditation, right? We can focus on our breathing, and we can like try to clear our head so that the next thing that we think about is palate cleansed. But we can't control that stuff. We can't change the things we feel. We can't change the direction our brain is going. We have to guide it into that space. And everybody's focus changes at a different pace. So your players might be able to jump right into the game, but you might take a little longer, or vice versa. There might be a mix of these things, and that's okay. I think being creative is especially tricky, and that's what playing a role-playing game is. It's especially tricky because saying, okay, time to be creative, time to be in the creative brain, doesn't work like that. You can't make it happen. And people are neurologically diverse, and some people, ADD or ADHD, totally things that can contribute to this difficulty. So that feeling that you have, that feeling of like an hour into the session, you're like, ugh, I can do better than this. Why is my brain so sluggish? What's the problem here? That's a normal feeling. Honestly, like for me, the middle 2 hours are the best parts of a role-playing session. I like 4-hour sessions. You get an hour warm-up, you get 2 hours of like real solid RPG time, and then you kind of wind down because it can be very tiring after 2 hours of intense RPG time. So you got to have an hour to like coast out of it or to like build to the next thing, right? So it takes time and energy to warm up to the place where you're working not only with your own brain and the game, but your own brain, the game, in the right mode with the players at the table to get everybody in sync. You're tuning your instruments. So besides taking it easy, right, besides slowly working up to the intense stuff, if it's possible, because we are all slaves to the narrative, there are a few tricks you can pull, I think, to help warm your brain up before you start play. So for me, to give a concrete example, the ritual of the swan song pregame chat, for me as a GM, was so useful. Not only because it gave everybody a chance to talk shit before we got down to business, and that's certainly a part of it. Getting all the like talk out is nice, but because it was 20 to 30 minutes of social time, not interacting necessarily. Go back and watch some of these pre-show talks, and you'll notice that a lot of them, I'm just listening to Wheat and Jeff talk. I'm listening to Steven and JP talk. I'm interjecting, but I'm mostly like taking notes. I'm doing things. I'm flipping through my book. Sometimes people will give me shit for that. They'll be like, oh, Adam's bored or Adam's not paying attention. But what I'm doing is I'm immersing myself in the social space to warm up to the idea that we're all going to have a conversation. I'm getting used to hearing their voices. I'm getting used to picking out the different things that they're saying from one another. And for me, I'm using that to move from the bullshit of my regular day, from all the other stuff I'd accumulated before that game, into I'm going to GM now, right? Taking notes, organizing prep, listening to my players, getting my head in the space, right? This is my for me, it was very much a pregame sort of ritual. And it's useful, I think, for role-playing game groups because it can give everybody at the table a chance to do that, to get into conversation mode, because we don't often spend our whole day in conversation. We spend a lot of time depending on our work, our family. If you're a student, you spend a lot of time being spoken to, but not necessarily engaging. And it's important to get your head in the right space. So that's important. And give yourself that. I lead with that as soon as I can. You lead with everybody just hanging out to the table, talking, sharpening pencils, fidgeting dice, laughing about shit, and just being sort of aimlessly, amorphously social. You're building up that conversational energy. You're priming the pump so that when you get into the game, you can fire that energy in a particular direction. And what you got to do, though, because this can get way out of hand, what you got to do is establish a parameter for this, establish a time frame. It might be the hour before the game, right? While people trickle in and you eat pizza together and you get caught up. This episode of Office Hours is brought to you by pizza. Or it might just be the 10 minutes before the game, right? For us, on roleplay, it's 20 to 30 minutes. And at that point we say, okay, we're done. Time to warm up. Like warm up time's done. Time to actually play the game. Either way, however you decide to do about this, have something you can do to signal the changeover into the game itself. Now, some games will give you a thing to do, a beginning of session move, like in Sagas of the Icelanders, or highlighting stats, or a recap of the last session, like in Mouse Guard or Torchbearer. If the game itself doesn't give you anything to do, consider finding something informal to do as a group anyway. The key here is the ritual. The key here is helping the group and yourself open the curtain between game and not game, right? The idea here is that you're saying, now it's time to do the other thing, right? Thank you for coming. We're ready to go. The big takeaways here is that warm-ups will always take time, no matter what, however you do them. This way, for me, feels like a good warm-up, but it takes time. And B, it's okay. You can work together to make it feel less jarring. You know, I know that when I'm GMing, my warm-up, I mean, hell, even if I'm playing a character in a role-playing game, I start warming up at the very beginning of the day, like as soon as I wake up, right? Like every day that I am on a show, I start to roll that show over in my head. I start thinking about the characters I'm going to need to portray, about the world that it's set in. If I do accents for my characters, I will start practicing them to myself. My warm-up, and again, I'm a special case because playing role-playing games is a huge part of my life and livelihood, and it's why all of you are here. But for you, find an amount of time. Maybe it's like when you get off school and you're driving home or you're on the bus. Maybe it's between the end of work and the start of your game. And just like let the game float around in your head, right? Idle time is great for this. When you're having a shower or walking from place to place. I love going for walks. I'm going to go for a walk as soon as we're done office hours, and I'm going to roll Court of Swords around in my head because I need to get some inspiration. And I find that movement is really good for warming up my brain. Not exercise necessarily, but just letting my brain process the differences between one place and another. For me, sitting still in one place means sort of stagnating a little bit mentally. So you'll find a ritual. Try different stuff that isn't necessarily about GMing that you can do to warm up before your game. And I know that this implies that you have time to do that on top of your prep and on top of your game, and I'm sorry that I'm assuming that. But that's the kind of thing that, for me, I really like doing. Now, if you're finding the beginning of your sessions still to like lag for you and you need that in-game warm-up, what I would suggest doing is try to structure your sessions episodically. Play a game like Dogs in the Vineyard that's meant to be structured one episode at a time, 4 hours of game or 6 hours of game or however long your session is. So that way, every game session starts with the ramp-up, the rising action, crests in the middle, and tapers off with an epilogue. Next session, ramp back up, rising action, plateau, epilogue, right? Denouement into the rising action of the next episode. So for you, it might help to either structure your game explicitly that way or play a game that is built for that kind of play. Look at ways you can hack games that you're already playing to work that way. I think a lot of games can be structured episodically. I mean, hell, if the players had been more aggressive and I had been more aggressive about framing scenes, we could have done Mirror Shades that way, or Swan Song for that matter. It could have been like, today on Mirror Shades, the Aztechnology Caper, right? Like it could have been that way. What I would suggest is try playing a game that is explicitly built for that a few times. Like try Fiasco, for example. Try Dogs in the Vineyard. See if that helps. See if that feels better for you. And if it does, excuse me, if it does, try that as a structure for your other games. Right? Again, this is just me reframing advice I always give. Look to the game for advice first. And then from there, apply either the structures of those games to your game or look for ways that you can trick your brain into doing what you want it to do. Hopefully that helps. If folks have any suggestions for episodic games that work in that structure, feel free to throw them in chat or in the comments, because I'm always interested in looking like one-shot games that work well in this sort of episodic way. I like running about new games, so help me out on this one. So for our last question, this one is similar. It talks about time. It talks about campaign structure. Let's see here.
Hey, Adam, this is Dre Keith. I've been GMing for a couple years. I've been going through several systems before finding two that I really enjoy. And I have two campaigns running at the moment that are going pretty well. Except for one of them, our Burning Wheel campaign, has been very infrequent. You know, last time we played it was a month ago, and you know, before that was a month. Last time we played it before that, and I don't know what to do exactly. I feel like we're playing it way too infrequently to really get much out of. Players, you know, forget stuff, and you know, I forget stuff, and I feel like we're not really getting the most we can out of the system. With us hardly playing it ever. I could probably start a new campaign with the players who can make it more frequently, but, you know, I don't exactly want to just end the campaign we're playing. Regardless, I guess I'm a bit of an empath with this, and I would like your advice on what should I do when I feel like scheduling really prevents a campaign from really, you know, going forward.
Dre Keith, thank you for your question. I've talked about something similar to this, about how to structure games with people dropping in and out, but I think this is different. I think this is about games that function or don't function based on people showing up to participate. I'm going to say this from experience. I'm going to talk about this directly from my own experience. Burning Wheel demands regular play with a regular group. It doesn't say so in the book necessarily, but I've found in my experience, unless you structure your game specifically to be like, we're looking at a vignette of whoever is available now, the next game will jump forward and look at a different group of people that are interconnected later. Unless you specifically set that out at the beginning of the game, if you're trying to do a traditional sort of day-to-day role-playing situation with Burning Wheel, it can be incredibly difficult. And the reason for this is that Burning Wheel is a game that's driven by the characters. And when a character is absent, it can throw off all the other characters. In the same way that I think Fate does this a little bit, where you build aspects about your character related to other characters, and if that character isn't there, like, say goodbye to being able to tag that aspect necessarily, or say goodbye to getting Artha for that belief. If you're like, I must protect Sir Galavir, and Sir Galavir is never around, you're never going to get that persona point. And more importantly, you'll never get that deeds point when you finally have to kill Sir Galavir to save the kingdom, which is your other, more primary belief. Right? That stuff is going to be very difficult to do if your game is structured in a sort of traditional moment-to-moment role-playing sense, and you're playing a game that's character-driven in the way that Burning Wheel is. So that leads me to the awkwardness of having to suggest that maybe you need to change some fundamental shit about your game. We'll get to that. So, some games you can go weeks without playing and just pick up where you left off. Some games it doesn't matter, right? Some games you play episodically, like the games we were just talking about. Other games, you know, you need to play out a particular arc. Apocalypse World, you can go, you know, 10 episodes and either call the campaign a quits or pick it up again and do another arc, right? Some games work well in seasons. Some games demand attention and detail to a degree that only by playing the campaign week to week can you get the full value out of them. I think Burning Wheel is somewhere between the latter two, depending on your group, the frequency of play, and the way you've structured your game. But really, I think you can do a few different things when you realize you're in this position, right? Look at what's causing the game to stall. Every game, think about your groups, right? Think about the groups of people you've played with before. Think about the games you've played. Every game has a threshold. Now, for me, in my current experience, that threshold is one player. It's one person. If we are missing a person for Adventurers League or Court of Swords, we don't play, because it's structured as a show, and that's just how, that's an external constraint. Now, your game might not work that way. I played a game of Dungeons and Dragons with 12 people, and if we missed two or three even people, it didn't matter. They could just come back. It was irrelevant. Our DCC game had 8 players at one time, and if we were missing one or two, it didn't matter. We had in-game stuff we could do to drop them out and bring them in. But with a game of Burning Wheel, with a small number of players, your threshold is probably one. So with a low threshold like that, you need to recognize that the game won't work unless everyone can commit to that. And that can be hard for people. So talking about that up front, knowing that about the game, is really important. I think the thing is that when this kind of stuff happens, you know, if somebody's not able to make it, if somebody can't make it a bunch of weeks in a row, or people keep dropping, it's like, it's like every relationship, really. You got to sit down with your players and you got to say, okay, everybody, you still feeling this? You still into this game? Do you still want to continue the relationship that we have with each other and this game? Does this still feel good to you? I'm giving you an opportunity for an out. I'm asking you, if you want to, there's the door. And I don't mean it in a, like, get the fuck out sense, but I mean it in a, like, you're allowed to leave. It's okay to be busy with your life. It's okay to not want to play this role-playing game anymore. it's all right. That's cool. Because people get uncomfortable, right? People get uncomfortable with the idea of saying no, and so they just cancel a bunch of times. You get that email an hour before the game, and they're like, you know, like, I forgot that I have this other thing I have to do. And, like, if people want to be in a relationship, if people want to play a game, play the game and be a part of it. And it's on them, too. Like, if they're feeling that, they should be able to say, like, I'm done. But you want to give them a chance to get out. Because social stuff can be awkward and difficult. And we're all nerds, so we're all, like, a little bad at it. So, I mean, that's a cliche, but let's go with it. Generally, when this kind of stuff happens, it can mean that the campaign itself and maybe the group is coming apart. And it's a sad reality, but it doesn't mean that all the players aren't interested. But if they're missing 3 or 4 weeks of the game at a time, they're not able to prioritize it. And it's just not as important to them. And with a game like Burning Wheel, you kind of have to engage as a group. You got to be in it. A week or two at a time isn't so bad, but if you're missing, like, months because everybody's taking a turn missing a session, that's going to fuck your game. So for a campaign in progress, this is when you do the check-in. You find out if these weekly absences are symptoms of a bigger problem or disinterest, and if they are, that's cool. Just, it's fine. Everybody is allowed to disengage when they want. If they all legit want to keep playing but can't make it, it's time to restructure, right? Play a different game. Play Burning Wheel, but build it such that you're doing it episodically. It's like, you know, when we watch Downton Abbey, we don't see every goddamn day of their lives. That show spans a mass amount of time for a TV show. So Downton Abbey that shit. Be like, today, something goes wrong, and some rich people are sad, but then poor people get raised up to be their servants, and hooray for everybody. And then we move on. And then the next one, we're like, yes, but the servants are uppity. And then some discipline has to be dealt. But it's not always the same people in the same place all the time. These things can be expanded on. And, yeah, right. Meanwhile, 3 years later. The thing is that if you can make that work with Burning Wheel, then great. Keep playing Burning Wheel. If not, it might be time to find another game that doesn't crash and burn if somebody misses a session or several sessions, or there's always somebody missing. If you like Burning Wheel, try Torchbearer, try Mouseguard. They both have mechanisms for reincorporating missing characters, right? You do the recap, you talk about everything beforehand, you get everybody caught up, the missing player says where their character was, and then you get back into the game. You know, I've definitely had games where that's been a thing, right? People drop out mid-campaign, people not being able to make it for weeks, and you have to make a decision as a group whether it's the right game for you or not. And not is an okay option. Not just in the sense that you all want to play the game or that it's about the right stuff, but is it productive to keep trying to engage given everybody's necessity for time and attention? Burning Wheel might not be the game for this group. I had to abandon one of my favorite Burning Wheel campaign premises because the group was having a problem with it. The game was a little bit antagonistic, their personal skills with each other weren't fantastic, and it was a big group, so we decided we're going to play something that's not this. And we played Dungeons & Dragons instead. Worked out a lot better for that group. Honestly, I mean, it's kind of the thing, right? Like, you've done this work already. You notice that there's a problem. You're not just sitting there being like, oh, guys, why can't you make the group? That's not an impression of your voice. That's just me doing it different. I'm sorry. Anyway, the point being, you can't do this alone. And acknowledging that problem with your players and looking at your options for solution, right? Players can leave, you can change the game, keep playing the same game with a different premise, look at ways to make the game more episodic, you know, Downton Abbey, that shit, and then try those solutions out with the group and with the people who have committed to playing. And I think with a question like this, that's as much as I can answer for you. I can give you the tools, but now you have to take them to your group and deal with your group as human beings. And God knows that's difficult enough, right? So good luck. This has been Office Hours, episode number 25. Thank you so much for coming. Apparently this episode has been sponsored by Delicious Pizza. I'm going to go and take a walk and think about the next role-playing game I have to run. And in the meantime, if you want to get your questions on Office Hours, go to my website, www.adam-coble.com. click on that office hours link, fill out that form, record your lovely voice for me, and we'll get to your question on a future episode of Office Hours. As always, thanks for coming. We'll see you next time.